church. Today we're going to be talking about substituting. Harry Ironside said that Christ is a substitute for everything, and there is no substitute for Christ. He's right. We're going to talk this morning about things that take the place of Christ in our life, and sometimes we don't even realize we're doing it. I hope you stay tuned. I think you're going to like the message this morning.
Good morning!
Yeah, you wake up. Ask the Lord's blessing. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come into your house this morning and to hear your word. May we hunger and thirst for it. May we, Lord, be blessed by this message this morning. In Jesus' precious name, amen. I hear music. Coming from your phone?
Yeah.
Turn her up.
Where's up?
Where's up? Sing to the phone. For salvation, our nation, and all those who serve. Lord, and we have Laura and Robin. They lost a child and a grandchild. I'm not going to go into the details of all what
lost
happened.
Two grandkids.
Yeah, two grandkids. Yep, two grandkids and a child. And yeah, I wasn't going to go into all that. So keep them in your prayers. For comfort and to get through this. Anybody else have anybody that?
Yes.
Jerry Connor is our oldest granddaughter's.
Jerry Connor.
Yeah, kind of a step grandfather, but not. But he's got stage 4 throat cancer.
Ouch.
Oh, my cousin. The guy
that her mother's
living with is
Connor, C-O-N-N-E-R.
Oh,
N-N-E-R.
Yes.
I got two families. First family is Deb and Chuck Taylor. They go to our home church. Deb Taylor, she has some serious heart health conditions. She's in hospital right now. She had a near-death experience a couple months ago, bounced back up, but she's not rebounding so much anymore. She's kind of like sinking. Her and her husband, cat behind her with his heart condition. Okay. And the other one, what's Lisa's little work daughter's name?
Briella.
She's like a six, seven-year-old little girl. And she has some serious health conditions. They might, if I remember reading this post, that might be like MS. Onset MS.
Yeah.
So for her and her family, I posted out, write her name and her family name in prayer. James.
Anybody else? Okay, thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for a God who is caring, a God who loves us and who meets our needs, regardless of what they are. When we have people on our prayer list, Lord, this morning that need healing, others need salvation, the good news is that, Lord, you know all of this. And so we bring them before you, before the throne of grace, and we leave them in your capable hands that you will heal, touch, minister, or whatever it takes for these people. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Things people substitute for Christ. Harry Ironside once said that Christ is a substitute for everything, but nothing is a substitute for Christ, and he's right. It's tragic that people without God try to fill a void, a big gaping hole where God should be, with things of substance, so they think. Things like drugs, alcohol, shopping, work, social positions, jobs, cars, so on and so on and so on. The list is endless. But they fail to realize that if God is missing in our lives, then that void cannot be filled with things. We cannot substitute anything for God, because whatever it is we try to substitute for God falls far short, leaves us wanting, and gives us less. Aaron, Moses' brother. Moses was up on the mountain talking to God. People of Israel were starting to rumble and complain and murmur. And so Aaron, instead of sticking with his faith, substituted. That's our message, substitution. And what did he substitute? He went and told the people of Israel to gather all of the gold that they had. And they come out of Egypt with a lot of gold. And so he tells them, bring it to me. So he melts it all down and makes this golden calf. And then he throws a big feast. And all of Israel is partying and worshiping this calf. Moses is up on the mountain talking to God. Israel's down below dancing with the devil. Number two is works. When I talk to people about Christ and ask them if they're saved or talk to them about salvation, they come up with things like, well, I'm a pretty good person. I try to remind them that no matter how good you are, you're not good enough. You're not good enough. In Romans 3, 10 and 11, it tells us that. See, all the... Well, I give 1 month of my check a year to an orphanage. That's terrific. That's terrific. Good for you. But see, what God tells us in Isaiah 64:6, that all of our good works, no matter what it is we think we do, is like filthy rags to God. So you can't do anything really good. No amount of good works is going to get us into heaven. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 tells us that. But listen, but people who are saved and are going to heaven their good works. That's for Christ. It's not a substitute for Christ. They do the good works that they do for Christ. Number three, religions. A study in the world religion found one recurring theme that most religions stress on things doing good is going to get you into heaven, wherever you think you're going to go when you die anyway. Most religions focus on the fact that doing will get you into heaven, where Christ has already done it. It's done. There's nothing in this universe that can substitute Christ's atonement. Nothing. No amount of doing anything is good enough to get you into heaven. No amount of religion. You know, it's not about religion. It's about having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Number four, substitution. There is no substitute for the precious blood of Jesus. Some say there are many paths to go to heaven. The Bible tells us that there is only one path, and that's through Jesus Christ the Lord. In Acts 4:12, you'll find that. There are two paths after death. One path you don't want to take. The other leads to the great white throne judgment. The other to hell and damnation. One leads to eternal life. That is found through Jesus Christ. That's found in John 6:44. The other, scripture tells us, is hell. That is fire, darkness, agony, endless suffering. You don't want to go there. So in conclusion this morning, Harry Ardenside was right when he said that Christ is a substitute for everything, and nothing can substitute Christ. If you don't have Christ in our lives, and I'm assuming that everybody here has, and we preach and give the invitation at the end of the service every Sunday. But if you don't have, listen to me, if you don't have Christ in your life, then you don't have eternal life. You're going to go the path of hell and damnation. Yes, Lord? Hello, Lord. Oh, now I get a busy signal I'm talking to.
You've been put on hold.
Steve Lawrence said that he often is often disturbed by statements that people make involving their lifestyle that are in direct conflict with God's scripture. They justify their actions by saying, well, hey, God wants me to be happy, and this makes me happy. Apparently, these people believe in God's promises or blessings, yes. But they ignore the command, God says, to be holy. It just completely goes over their head. One of the most fundamental problems in the spiritual order of things is that we sense a need for God in our lives. We want to have. But then we attempt to satisfy that hunger that we have for God with some things that we create that are less than God in our lives. Thomas Aquinas said this: there are four typical substitutes we have for God. One, wealth, pleasure, power, and honor. And he's right. There's more, but them are the basic four main ones. So this morning, let's do a self-check and be honest with ourselves. Have we or are we substituting things in our life where God should be? That's the question you have to answer by yourself. All right. Thank God and his blessing upon his message. Ron, you want to come on up here and we'll try to do for you? Now, communion. What is it? Why do we have it? We take communion as a retirement. Go ahead, pass them up. As a reflection. Communion is a time to look back at the cross and remember what Jesus accomplished for us. Communion is a time to look within and to right some wrongs, to be forgiven for things that we need to be forgiven for. Communion is a time to look forward, to observe and remind ourselves that Christ is coming back for us. It's a time for recommitment of our lives to God. In 1 Corinthians 11:24 says, "And when he had given thanks, he broke and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' Shall we partake together?" In verse 25, "In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is my new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me.' Shall we partake?" In verse 26, "As often as you eat the bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death.
Was lost.
thank you. Help us today, Lord, take this message with us and feed upon it, thirst upon it. Substitute. We do it all the time. You go to the grocery store and they don't have what you want, you grab something else, it's a substitute for what you want. Help us to want you more than the substitute. We praise you, Lord God. And for anybody who is here this morning that has substituted you for something else in life, we give you a chance to come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. It's a simple prayer, sinner's prayer. I'll say it, you repeat it to yourself. It goes like this. Father, I know I'm a sinner. Your word has told me. And the best way I know how, Lord, I open up the door to my heart. I ask you to come into my life. Fill me with your spirit and your presence. Forgive me of my sins. Lord, I want to be with you in glory when I pass from this life to the next. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless. Have a great week.